What do you know about twin primes, Brady?
I know that they are prime numbers that are separated by two. Is it proven there are an infinite number of them? Or is that still... No, they haven't got the twin prime conjecture yet, have they?
The twin prime conjecture is still called a conjecture. And James Maynard talks about that on Numberphile regularly. They've got the gap down, but if they can get the gap to two to prove that there is always going to be another pair of twin primes no matter how far you look, then it'll be a big deal in mathematics. Not because necessarily that solves the world's problems, but it's a problem we don't really know how to solve at the moment. I don't know, I feel like I have an affinity with twin things. I have a twin brother, which some number five viewers may have heard about on a podcast. But let's explore a fact about twin primes. I'm not in James Maynard territory here. I am a math teacher, not an A-grade mathematician. But I'd like to try a little experiment. I'm going to write down a number which you can't see. I'm going to write it on the back of this.
Okay, you're going to write it there.
A prediction, yeah.
Can't see what you're writing.
And I need you to grab a calculator. You could do this in your head, but I don't think you should.
Okay.
I'd like you to pick your favourite pair of twin primes.
Oh,
put you on the spot now.
All right, well, I can't go too high. I'm going to go... I think I've picked two that are prime. Yeah, all right.
And I'd like you to... I mean, it doesn't matter if I see what you're doing, because I've made my prediction, right? I can't go and change it. I'd like to find the product of those two twin primes.
17 times 19.
And then I'd like to find the digital root of that, by which your face is good. It's a shame viewers can't see your face, Brady. The digital root is a technical name for add the digits together, and if you don't get down to a single digit, you do it again. So digital sum repeated.
All right, so the digital root of that is 8.
Really? Do you want to just have a little glimpse here? At the number 8, which I've carefully written, yes, I'm glad we're impressed by this. It's not a good magic trick, but it is a curious thing that I knew what was going to happen. And did I know because I got lucky? And I think we should try the experiment again. 101 times 103. I feel like I should be able to work this out, but for the sake of speed, let's just trust the electronics. This is 10,403, and I add the bits together, the digits 1 and 4, that's 8. Let's try another pair. I'm going to go and look up a pair of twin primes.
I just found 617 and 619.
617. Times 619 and add the digits, we're going to get 26. If you do it again, it goes to 8. But I'm glad you chose a larger example. Sometimes the digital root takes a couple of steps to get down there. Sometimes it takes a lot longer. But it does look like it's always going to be 8. And so that's quite a nice fact, if you believe it, that the product of any twin primes has a digital root of 8. And for all the things we don't know about primes and the things we don't know about twin primes, do we know that that's true, or is it just a fluke in the first few examples?
And that's... Or do all primes do this? Like 7 and 11, which aren't twin primes?
Should we try? I mean, 77. Add the digits.
14, 5. So 5 is the digital.
Counterexample. The Brady conjecture was nice for a moment, but we found a counterexample. Actually, a serious point, like mathematicians finding counterexamples to disprove things is just as important, right? You reject the dross. Sorry to insult your conjecture. So not all prime products of primes do this. We've checked 3 examples, but obviously that's not enough. So what I'd like to do in this video is prove it. I'd like to prove it in 2 different ways. Just a point that if something is true, there's not one way to prove something, and then proof becomes less about getting the answer right and more about a communication. And it's something which is a lot overlooked in mathematics. The stereotype of it being right or wrong is actually much more about communicating well. So we'll do 2 proofs of the digital root of a product of twin primes being 8. Proof 1, ready? So I'm going to talk about modular arithmetic here, and there doesn't feel like there's anything to do with this until you recognize that almost anything when you talk about digital roots is to do with thinking about modulo 9. Now, you know about modular arithmetic, but just as a reminder, it's where you, if I'm going to count in mod 9, I would count up to 9, but 9 would be the same as going back to the beginning and 0. And so the number 10, mod 9, is 1, because it's 1 more than a multiple of 9. And the number 26, Should have planned this, shouldn't I? It's 8 more than a multiple of 9. So it would be 26 equals 8 mod 9. And the reason I'm doing that is anytime you're talking about digital roots, mod 9 comes into play for reasons which we'll come to maybe as a bonus proof at the end. But if I think about things mod 9, I'm going to think about the prime numbers mod 9. So just work with me here. The prime numbers, as you know, start with 2. I'm not going to get into the argument about 1, and it's not important anyway, because Actually, when I was going to do this trick, I should have said to you, can you pick two twin primes bigger than three? And I didn't say that because people normally do. But I do need to say bigger than three, and that'll become obvious why. Have I got these 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, 13? Let's go up a little bit further. The next one I think is 17, and then 19, and then we've got a jump to 23. Let's go with that. So if I go mod 9, I'm looking for the remainder dividing by 9. Now, the first few are pretty easy, even for me, but this 11, just help me out, Brady. Mod 9, what's left over if you took away multiple of 9?
2.
Yeah, I agree. And so if everyone else is keeping up, that's fine. That's a 4. This is almost up to the 18, so that's going to be the highest you can get mod 9. And that's going to be one more than mod 9, and that's going to be, by definition, 4 more than that, so it's got to be 5. Do you have any comments about the list we're getting here? And I'm actually going to kind of separate these two. Because they are the first primes, they're often special. This is the only even prime, and that is the first odd prime. Beyond that, what's the next one going to be? 29? And that's a 2. Spoiler, it doesn't repeat. And maybe we'd be worried if it did, because the pattern of primes is notoriously important and unpredictable, and all sorts of Riemann hypothesis stuff is tied up with this. And I'm not going there, but do you think we would ever get a 3 in there?
I'm guessing not, but I'm just trying to figure out why.
Okay, let's start with a simple one. Will you ever get a 0?
No, because it will be a multiple of 9.
Right. If you get a 0 mod 9, it's a multiple of 9, and therefore definitively not prime. Now, 9 has a factor of 3 in it. So will you ever get a 3? Will you ever find a prime number which is 3 more than a multiple of 9?
No, because it will be a multiple of 3.
Yeah, so 3's out as well. And for the same reason, 6. And actually, that's it. We've seen the others. 0 is not there. 1, 2, 3 is out. 4, 5, 6 is out. 7, 8. That's all of them. So the first conclusion is you're never going to get 0s, 3s, and 6s. That doesn't feel like it's rocket science, if you understand primes. But it does have a consequence, because when we pick a pair of twin primes, it means if we work in mod 9, we're only going to get either, what did we say, a 1, a 2, not a 3, a 4, a 5, not a 6, a 7, or an 8. Those are the only options we have mod 9. And a twin prime is going to have to be 2 apart, literally the definition of twin primes. So we've actually not got many options left. What I'm going to do is kind of a proof by exhaustion. I couldn't do the original thing by checking all the cases. But the nice thing about working modular arithmetic is that you quite often turn it from an infinite list into a finite list, and then you can check everything. So if I found a twin prime that ended up 2 mod 9, I'd need to have the other twin mod 4. So if you do 2 times 4, you get 8 mod 9. The big step I haven't commented on is that what is mod 9 got to do with digital roots? Well, everything, and I want to save that for the end. But if I tell you now that the digital root of a number is exactly the same as it mod 9. We can prove that later if we need to. But that's it. So if I found 2 twin primes that are 2 and 4 multiplied, they're going to get 8 mod 9, which is the digital root. So the only other option, we could have a 4 matching with a 6. No, we can't have that. We could have 5 matching with 7. 5 times 7, 35, which goes digital root to 8. So that one's working. What else could we do? 7 would need to match with a 9, but that 9's not on the list. 8 would need to match with a 10, but 10 is 1 mod 9. So we could have an 8 and a 1, and that is also 8. And that's it. Whatever you do, if you pick 2 twin primes and multiply them together, you're going to get an answer which is 8 mod 9, which is the same as the digital root. And so it's a slight obfuscation. I'm just saying, if you multiply 2 twin primes, the way the primes distribute themselves, you're always going to get 8 mod 9. And I quite like it.
I do feel like I need to see why mod 9 is digital roots.
Should we do that now?
I feel like I want to see it. Yeah.
Okay, let's do that now. Digital root is equivalent to mod 9. That's my claim. And I'm going to prove this in a way that you could do more generally, but for the sake of notation, I'm going to do an example of a 3-digit number. If you imagine a 3-digit number as ABC, it could be 321, could be 926, whatever. I'm not treating these as multiplying together, they're just representing the digits. Algebraically, that would be written as 100 lots of A plus 10 lots of B plus C. And I think that's, after a moment's thought, if that's not familiar, it's not too surprising, because hundreds, tens, and units are a sort of helpful thing. Now, if you wanted to upgrade this proof to do a 4-digit number, you just have 1,000 of another letter at the front. And you could do this in general, it just gets notationally confusing. And I want a proof to be notationally not confusing to get the sense of it. And then you can upgrade the formality later on. So the digital root of this number ABC is A plus B plus C. Agreed?
Yep.
It's the three digits added together. Maybe you do it again if it doesn't come to a single digit, but that's the step you do. So that's the sum of the digits. And now I'm going to work on the actually algebraic version of the number to show you that this, that it's equivalent to mod 9. So 100A, it won't be surprising to you to learn, is the same as 99A's plus A. And the catch here is you don't know why I'm doing that. And I've done something similar with the 10B, I turned it to 9B plus B. And the reason I've done that is that I've got in this algebraic expression, I've got this A, B, and C, which is kind of what I'm aiming at over here. So if I rewrite this as 99A's plus 9B's plus ABC, you can see that the sum of the digits is in the number itself. And what's left is 9 times something. And that's it. Proof two, we're trying to prove again that twin primes, the product of a twin prime pair has a digital root of 8. Imagine twin primes. I'm going to imagine a number n, the next number is n plus 1, and the number before it is n minus 1. I'm going to claim that if you have a twin prime, they are going to be 2 apart. This is not representing its primeness yet, but I'm going to say if that is one of your twin prime, then that's the other one. It's instructive maybe to look at the product of these two things. All I'm doing is checking the product of numbers 2 apart at the moment. So n minus 1 comes n plus 1. So let me upgrade slightly. I'm going to say that in this list of three numbers that we started with, certainly one of them is going to be divisible by 3. Again, it feels so obvious when you realize why, like, but there's a list of three numbers, right? So if that one's divisible by 3, we're done. If that one's not divisible by 3, then either this one is or this one is, because this is a list of three numbers.
One in every three numbers is divisible by 3.
Exactly. If they are primes, because they're twin primes, they are not divisible by 3. Agreed? So this one is divisible by 3. So I'm going to call it 3k. We've sort of upgraded our information. If these are twin primes, then this one is a multiple of 3. Guaranteed. In fact, we just proved by thinking that every twin prime has a multiple of 3 buried between them, and it's not really that surprising when you think about it. So if we upgrade, then instead of using n, I'm going to use 3k, then this expression becomes slightly different. The product of the twin primes looks like 3k minus 1 multiplied by 3k plus 1. Let's do some algebra. Expanding brackets live on camera is always dangerous. This is going to be nk squared minus 1. So the product of twin primes is going to look like that. K is an integer. It's been multiplied by 9. It's been squared as well, but I don't really care about that. Tell me about this, mod 9. It's negative 1 mod 9, but we didn't put that in our original list, and negative 1 is going backwards from 0. So mod 9, I could add 9 and get away with it. I just wanted the 8 to appear in the digit, so this equals 8 mod 9. And that is, it feels like a really different proof to me. We haven't done a proof by exhaustion. We haven't gone to check the mod 9s of all the primes. We just did an algebraic argument, identified that there was a multiple of 3, and then the algebra tells us, well, it's going to be 9k squared plus 8. And that's it. I don't think this is a great magic trick. I know I presented it a bit like that, but I like the idea that once you've got a fact which is always true, it feels like you can exploit it. And I'm not saying this is a useful fact. It's just a curiosity about twin primes, which we can prove in several ways. So first of all, that exists, and I like it. And secondly, I like reflecting as a mathematician on which proof do you prefer? Because there isn't a right proof and a wrong proof. There's a proof which works for you, and there's a proof which works better for you or worse for you. And I'm trying to redeem mathematics from being this robotic thing to be a human enterprise. We're communicating truth. I'm sounding very highfalutin, but the proof is important.
I think I liked the second proof.
The algebraic one. Mm. Yeah, I think I agree.
Because I didn't see it coming, as obviously.
The algebra just drops out suddenly. Mm. Whereas the first one feels like it's a tedious listing thing, and proofs by exhaustion often feel like that. And proofs by exhaustion are exhausting to check, they feel fiddly, they feel like, yeah, you've reduced it, but you've got to check them all. This feels like, bam.
This episode has been supported by Brilliant, makers of fantastic courses and puzzles like these that you can do from the comfort of your computer or tablet or your phone. Get smarter, have fun learning, enjoy these super interactive and lovingly designed lessons. Everything about Brilliant's created with care, with the aim of improving the way you think. This new everyday math course has some great practical stuff in it. If you haven't signed up to Brilliant yet, you don't know what you're missing. And if you have, well, why not consider Brilliant as a gift? It's really great for people of all ages. Some of it's simple, some of it gets more advanced. You can also get 20% off a premium subscription by going to brilliant.org/numberphile. You can go and have a look at the website without a subscription, of course, but make sure you use the / Numberphile for the discount. Thanks, Brilliant, for supporting this episode.
All right. It's a mouse.